appreciate what y'all do for me. And I do. I have a word for you this morning. And I want it to really make a difference in your life. So there's some things we've got to take care of first. So I want to give an opportunity for everyone that was involved with stealing my award yesterday to come and repent so the Holy Spirit can move in your life. Because if not...
You went to the whole church out there?
I know. That's what I feel like. I can just pray for you where you are. Because my understanding is everyone was involved.
We don't play favorites.
But I can handle it. That was all right. I had no problem losing. I was talking to Jeff last night, and I said, so I said, what was your time? And he told me, and I said, beat me by about a little over 3 minutes. I said, how old are you? He's 32. I said, I'm 51. I'm good. I'm happy with it. I know Pastor Bob and Debbie have talked about it. I do want to extend an invitation, though. The financial conference is coming up just the week after next, May 2nd through the 6th. And I mean, I'm not pressuring, but Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday, Brother John Evanzini is going to be with us. And I'm not prophesying any of these generals are dying, but, you know, he's in his mid-80s, and we're not going to have him around much longer. And he doesn't travel anymore. And, well, what do you mean he doesn't travel? He's coming to the financial conference. He called Pastor Callahan and said, if you'll have me, I'd love to come. And that wasn't a tough decision to make. I don't know that there's anyone outside of my pastor that's influenced me more in the area of biblical finances than Brother John has. And so if you can, if not, I mean, I encourage you to be there. I love all the technology, but I really believe there's many times technology is hurting our walk with God. Because we have the mentality, I can just watch online, I can listen online, I can get this tape, we don't get tapes, praise God. I get the CD, I can download the MP3s. But there's nothing like being in that anointing. And so I encourage you, if you can't make it, we'll live stream all of the services. Every night at 7 o'clock, the live stream will start about 20 till. And so I encourage you to be a part of that. Before I get into the Word, if it's okay, I want to share a little bit about what we're doing. This is very difficult for me. I just do what I do. I just do what God's called me to do. I'm not comfortable talking about it. You all know, last year when I came here and tried to sell a book, I just said, hey, I wrote a book. If you want it, here it is. And so Debbie came and said, let me sell your book for you. But, I mean, God is opening amazing doors to us. And I have nobody else. I can't attribute it to anything else. I'm not trying. I don't send letters out. I don't make phone calls trying to get places to preach. And it's just miraculous what God is doing. Just a few weeks ago, Elizabeth and I were in Brussels. You want to talk about how good our God is. The bombing at the Brussels airport was 20 feet from where we check in with United, exactly 24 hours after we left. And I don't think like a terrorist, but if I was going to be a terrorist, I would blow up an airport on Monday, which is the busiest travel day of the week. But God. And exactly 24 hours later, you know, it was right in front of the Starbucks, which is right where the United desk is. And God's so good to us. And so we were just in Brussels. We leave May 11th. That's the Wednesday after the financial conference. We leave the 11th for Angola to go the weekend there. And we go to Brazil in July. That's a new door that God has opened to us. We just returned from Peru. Monday night we got home from Peru. And I'm telling you, what God is doing there is amazing. The healings that we see. We always have people ask us, you know, what to tell us about some of the healings. And it's honestly, it's difficult to remember because there are so many. When we say every trip, we see hundreds of people healed. That's not an exaggeration. And the main ministry there is radio, which we can't comprehend that. Because, you know, we listen to radio, but there, that's their main form of communication because a lot of people can't afford televisions. And so where we minister is a radio and a TV station. And we'll go in, Pastor Callahan and I will go in 10 o'clock in the morning, and we will preach and take phone calls for 2.5 hours every day. And it's nonstop. And we can't get to them all. They'll bring us a stack of prayer requests that thick of people that they couldn't get through to talk to us. And so I want to share just a couple of those testimonies. I had a mother call in. She had a 4-year-old little boy that was blind in his right eye. And so I said, is he there with you? She said, no, let me go get it. And it was like, you know, 4 or 5 minutes that she was gone. And he was outside playing. And he was not happy about having to come back inside to have this funny talking guy pray for him. And so I prayed for him, and he didn't get his manifestation at that time. And so we went on, kept taking phone calls. And about 20 minutes later, a woman called in, and she said, I was listening when you prayed for that little boy for his eye to be open. She said, I took the prayer for myself. I was totally blind, and now I can see. I mean, that's how amazing God is. And so one of the things that God had laid on my heart on our way there was, I want to see the miracle of metal dissolving in people's bodies. Two of the major people that God is using right now in healing, the greatest, is Randy Clark and Bill Johnson. And there's a couple books. If you want to press into healing, which I don't know why you wouldn't, but if you want to press into healing, then I highly recommend getting and reading. The first one is a book called Healing Unplugged. I think I talked about it when I was here last year. And what that book is literally an interview where Randy Clark interviews Bill Johnson. And then the second half of the book, Bill Johnson interviews Randy Clark about how'd you get into the ministry of healing, how do you get words of knowledge, how does God use you? I'm kind of pressing him because I want Pastor Callahan and I to sit down and do the exact same thing. I want to do the exact same kind of book. And so one of the things that they're seeing on a regular basis is metal dissolve. They'll have a word of knowledge, and they'll have people go test it. And so that just, God had just laid that on my heart on the way as we were going to Peru. And I told Pastor, we're on the way to the airport. I said, I know this trip we're going to see metal dissolve. And so one of the afternoon television sessions, a woman came in, and I was excited because she had this huge, I mean, it was an ugly wound on the side of her ankle. It just wasn't healing. I wasn't excited about an ugly wound. But when she explained to me what was going on, she had had surgery that would never heal up where they put a metal plate in her ankle. She couldn't bend it. She couldn't put weight on it. She couldn't move around on it because the metal caused so much pain. And all I did, I stood in front of her and I said, so you can't jump around. And my interpreter said what I said, and she started jumping around, started dancing, started moving her ankle around. Absolutely nothing wrong with it. And I said, that's it. Now, I can't prove that metal dissolved, but what she couldn't do before we got there, she can now do with no pain. It's always interesting to me how people react when they get healed. Because you have some people that will jump and shout. We had one woman started jumping around when she got healed, and money started flying out of her pocket. I know people say that, and I can get money out of anybody. But another woman came up, and I don't know, I have no medical training whatsoever, which is very obvious, but she had a tumor that caused bleeding constantly. Every time she went to the bathroom, she passed blood. In excruciating pain, you could feel the tumor. It was right here. And so I prayed for her. The pain left immediately. And I kept telling her, just keep checking. And about the third time, I said, check again. Now, I'm not against praying again. But the Lord didn't tell me to pray again. I just told her to keep checking. And by the third time she checked, the tumor was completely gone. There was absolutely no pain left in her body. And you'd have thought somebody had killed her puppy. That's all she did. I said, are you happy you got healed?
Yeah.
I said, could you please tell your face? I mean, there was no reaction. The bird just flew into the window. It'd be honest. Yeah, really. It is one of my favorite stories about one of our pastors, and I'm not going to mention her name, but she's in Louisville. When we were first getting started, learning faith and getting a hold of things, and she had a bird that had the same thing happen, flew into the front of the house and was laying in front of the house, you know, dying. And so the Pastor Sherry, I'm not going to tell you who it is, she said she went out in her front yard and she picked up that book, or that bird, and she's going, I speak life. I got too much faith on the line. Join the circle of life. Now,
she doesn't like me telling that story.
I sure enjoy it. So, I mean, we're seeing major things happen in Peru. The last week of July, after the word rally, we leave for Brazil. This is a door that God opened. A pastor and his wife that we met in Angola, he says, I do two major conferences a year, and I want you there. And so we're flying to Brazil. Oh, the second book that I wanted to tell you about is written by a man named Ed Roca. Ed Roca was the interpreter for Randy Clark in Brazil. R-O-C-H-A is how you spell his last name. And it's called How to Get Healed and How to Stay Healed. And it's just an outstanding book on how to, not just for yourself, it's very good for yourself how to walk in healing, but also how to pray for other people. And that was one of the most exciting things we did in Peru this trip, is the Friday night service was leadership. And so Pastor and I split up a message, a four-part message on how to pray for the sick, and taught them how to pray for the sick. And we didn't tell them we were going to do this. Now, what we always do when we're there is after we minister, we'll call up two people that are in a lot of pain. And then Pastor will pray for one, I will pray for one, they're totally healed, and we're letting the people see that what we're teaching you is true. These people were in a lot of pain, now they're healed. Well, we did that, and then we called the leaders up and had the leaders pray for each other that were sick. They were all healed. And then we had all the leaders turn and face the congregation. Then we called people from the congregation up who had pain or were sick. They were all healed. They were so excited, which is what we want to do. We want to teach ourselves out of a job. We don't want to be the only ones doing this. T.L. Osborne said, if you knew what I knew, you could do what I do. And that's my goal. I have no desire to be the only one. I'm the same as Brother Hagin was. If I could do what I do behind a curtain and nobody know me, that's exactly how I'd do it. I remember years ago, that's not how I used to be. You know, I wanted everybody to know who I was and what I could do. And the only thing I knew back then is I knew everything. The only thing I know now is I got so much more to learn. We're just getting started. I do want to mention to you, some of you know this, some of you follow. We're on Periscope. You can follow me. If we have Wi-Fi when we travel, you can follow on Periscope. On Mondays when I'm home, if I'm traveling, I don't do it, but every Monday at 11 o'clock our time, I just do a little five-minute teaching. You can download Periscope on your phone and follow me at PastorJS5265. And we also, every time we travel and periodically, send out an email to people that are partnered with us. And so if you want to be on that, you want us to keep in touch with you, I have really nice partnership cards that are back in my briefcase at the house.
We have some here.
So do you have some here? Got some back there. And if you ever get an email, a letter, a note, a phone call from me asking for money, it is not from me. I don't do that. I don't ever ask for money. And so understand that's not what this is about. But we do. We just want to let you know what we're doing, but we want you to be a part of it. We can't do what we do on our own. We're never intended to do it that way. But let's get into work. Go with me to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. And it's funny. I have been doing this for a little while. I'm pastoring now. As a matter of fact, last week marks 25 years in the ministry. I've been pastoring for 21 of those years, assistant pastor for 24 of those years. And I've noticed something about people, and there's a trap that faith people can fall into, and it's what I want to deal with this morning. And I want to get you, if you're in that trap, I want you to get out of it. I want to ask, how many people are believing for something? Because we're faith people, you better always be believing for something. One of the biggest mistakes that we make in our walk of faith is when we get what we're believing for, we stop doing the things that got us to where we are. You know, I'm not believing for anything, Pastor. I don't need anything. No. There's always something that we can believe for. That's why Paul said, you don't press for the prize. I've watched so many people come into church because they needed something. You know, I need to save my marriage. I need a healing in my body. We need a house. They're getting ready to take everything I own. And that's the prize they're after. So when they get the prize, all of a sudden they don't need church anymore. That probably didn't happen in Illinois. It just happens in Kentucky and every other place in the world we've ever been. And so, but the other thing that we can get caught up in is we're always looking for that thing that we're believing for. And we're not going to be happy until we get that thing that we're believing for. Now, let me give you some examples of what I'm talking about. So many people live their lives with the attitude, I'll be happy when. Every one of us went through the period of time, you know, when we were young, when we were kids, I'll be happy when I'm older. I'll be happy when I'm married. I'll be happy when I'm thinner. I'll be happy when I have kids. I'll be happy when my kids are older. I can still remember, 31 years ago, coming home from the hospital in our little two-bedroom apartment. Every week, the police carried someone out. We're not talking about a nice side of town. As a matter of fact, the entire apartment building was infested with roaches. And so we found this stuff. It has to be illegal now. But it was called Roach Be Gone. And it was a white powder that you would put all the way around the perimeter of your house. And so we had this little white, we looked like coke dealers. We had this little white line all the way around the outside of our apartment. And every month, you'd go through our apartment complex, and there'd be notes on the door that said, you know, our kitchen's infested, our bedroom closet's infested with roaches. Ours said, please don't spray. They must have thought we were crazy. But I remember coming home, you could stand in the living room, see the kitchen, the living room, and both bedrooms. And I remember bringing Christian home, our oldest daughter, home from the hospital, thinking, it's going to be 6 years before she goes to school. I remember like it was yesterday. You know, I'm 20 years old, and I'm like, oh my God, how are we going to do this for 6 years? Now, we got 5 grandkids. And it goes by like that. And we learn, one of the things I try to get across to young parents is learn to enjoy every stage of your kids' lives. You know, don't be, well, when they finally get out of diapers, well, then they start pooping in their pants. And you're wishing you could go back to the days of the diapers. Like, I can just throw that thing away. There's a lot of pair of underwear we threw away. That ain't worth it. They make more. You know, I'll be happy when I have kids. I'll be happy when my kids are older. I'll be happy when my kids leave home. I remember going through that process when our kids were leaving home. We had never been by ourselves. You know, we were married at 19. We had kids right away. 3 kids by the time we were 22 years old. We've never been alone. And then all of a sudden, they all moved out, and we find out we like being alone. It's all right. You know what? We left the house this morning. We came home tonight, and it looks the same. Nothing's been moved. And I know people with young kids are going, oh God, I'll be so glad when we're there. No. We got to learn to be happy. Yes. We have to learn to have joy where we are right now. And because what the devil wants you to do is keep looking at what things are going to be like. But if you don't have, see, he's after your joy.
Yes.
Because Nehemiah 8 says, it's the joy of the Lord that's your strength. And there is always something in whatever your circumstance to thank God for.
Yes, right.
You can always find something.
That's right.
And so I gave a challenge about a month ago, I don't know, about 3 weeks ago on Facebook. And I said, I want you, because I did this to my church. I said, I want you to fast complaining for 3 days. And some of the responses I got were hilarious. I had one woman text me back, and she goes, I made it a day. And then I went to Walmart. I mean, you really want to challenge that complaining thing, go to Walmart after 10 p.m. I had, you know, and it was, I made it 2 days, Pastor. I made it till I woke up. And it's amazing, if you're not conscious of your complaining, you're so used to your complaining, you don't even know you are. Because you ask anybody, are you a complainer? No. I don't complain about anything. I mean, I've had a bad day today. It's hot out. But let's go to Philippians chapter 4. And let's go to verse number 10, because I believe Paul, if anybody had a right to complain, I believe the Apostle Paul did. I mean, you read down through the list back there in Corinthians, how many times he was beaten with rods and left for dead and shipwrecked. I wouldn't want to travel with him. But he says here, Philippians chapter 4, verse number 10, he said, "But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care, you have revived your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned before, but you lacked opportunity." Now, Paul's talking about this whole letter to the church at Philippi is a partner letter. They are the only church. He says it. There is no church that has communicated with me concerning giving and receiving except you. They're the only church that consistently supported Paul. But I believe Paul gives us a key here. He says, verse number 11, he said, "Not that I speak in respect of want." He says, "For I've learned." Now look, I'm going to say in Pastor Jim's term, I've learned a secret. I'm content in whatever state I am. I can find something. Now, do you understand the history of where Paul was when he wrote the letter to the church at Philippi? He's in prison, chained in the sewer system of the palace. That's where he is. Now, Rick Renner has done quite a bit of research in his book, A Light in the Darkness, which is a Bible study held. It's outstanding. He describes this prison. In terms that we would understand, it would be like they would lift a manhole cover off, drop you down into the septic tank of the palace, and put the cover back on. Yeah, you think you've had a bad day? I don't know about you, but I've had to work on septic systems at the church. Y'all are full of it. That's all I got to say about it. People see where we are now, and they're like, "Oh, Pastor Jim, I want to do what you do." You better be willing to go through what we've gone through. One of our word rallies, now, you probably don't notice it because, you know, you're so spiritual and caught up with God, but as you walk into the sanctuary in Lexington, there's a circle of bushes to the left. Behind that circle of bushes is the piece of equipment that I lovingly refer to as the poop grinder. I mean, more intellectual people will call it a sewage lift station, but it's nothing but a poop grinder. Because anybody that uses it, I can't convince people to stop at Speedway on the way to church. Which makes a lot more sense to me. And so we got 3 stalls in the women's restroom, 3 toilets in the men's restroom that all dump into this sewage lift station that then pumps it into a septic tank and into the leach field. If you don't understand this, if you're not a plumber, it's bad when that stops working. And it did during a word rally. Yeah. So every morning, Pastor Jim gets to the church at 6 a.m., runs a hose down into the sewage lift station, hooks a pump to it, runs a hose all the way through the parking lot into the septic tanks at the front of the church. Let me just help you understand, that's a crappy job. Now I know what it was like just having to open that cover. Yeah, you're right. No, you can't do it justice. You can stick your head down the toilet, you still would not understand. Now why am I going into such detail? Because Paul was chained in that. One of the things that no one ever made it out of that prison. No one did. Paul was the first. That's historic. I mean, that's historically true. That's what Rick Renner has studied out. There's no other record of somebody making it out because, I mean, think about it, beloved, as far as medically, what would happen in your body, you're submerged in sewage. Rats are living in there eating on the people chained. When somebody dies, they just wait until I want to paint this picture to you because I don't know what you're going through, but it ain't all that. They would just let the dead bodies float and decompose. You want to talk about sickness and disease and smell And Paul says, I've learned a secret. No matter what state I'm in, I'm content. You're content in poo? Because I'm telling you something. It's something we got to get a hold of. Because we get this mentality of, I'll be happy when. You know, when I'm out of this battle, Pastor. See, I've told you this before, and I threatened my church that I'm going to mount mirrors all over this wall. And you know why I want to mount mirrors on that wall? So you can see what I have to look at. You know, you're up here preaching a message you've gotten from the heart of God. You look out and they're like,
you have no idea, Pastor.
And I know that's what people are convinced of. You talk about stuff like this, and like, you have no idea what I'm going through. As a matter of fact, one morning during that word rally, I'm running the hose down into the stuff. We'll leave it at that. I'm hooking the pump. Let me just tell you something. The hose is leak. And so I'm doing, I want y'all to get this picture. And so I'm setting this, my whole apparatus up, plugging the pump in, and make sure you put the hose on the other side of the pump before you turn the pump on. All I'm saying about that. And this one pastor comes walking in his nice clothes, getting ready for the morning session. This is what he said. He walks up and goes, you know, I'd offer to help you, but you probably let me. And walked into the sanctuary. I wanted to stick my thumb over the end of that hose. Look at what Paul said. He said, not that I speak in respect of want, for I've learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. I know how to get along with humble means. I also know how to live in prosperity. What's he saying? My attitude is not based on my present circumstances. It has nothing to do with that. But how many of us live our lives based on present circumstances? Let me help you with something financially. Because too many of us let the present circumstance dictate what I'm doing in my giving. You're never going to walk in God's level of prosperity if circumstances are dictating what you do with your money. Because here's the tendency, is when everything's good, we're not selling. Because I don't need anything. I'm good, Pastor. But if you go back, and I bring this out almost every time I'm here, I'm trying to get it across. I'm trying to get it in me. I'm trying to get it across to people. Ecclesiastes chapter 11 says, give a portion to 7 and also to 8 because you don't know what evil is going to be upon the earth. That says in God's system financially, I'm not let, because here's what we do. We all do it. The circumstance arises. We know enough that seed time and harvest will take care of this, right?
Right.
We know enough that seed time and harvest is how we get our needs met, right?
Yes.
So the need arises,
yes.
We put our seed in the ground, and how many have ever done that process, and the only problem is harvest didn't come in time? And we get mad at God, and we don't say that out loud, but we get mad at God. Anybody honest enough? You know, but the analogy is, if I want to eat corn tomorrow, planting corn seed today is not going to do me any good. If I want corn tomorrow, I had to have my seed in the ground 6 weeks ago. And so, praise God for the mercy of God, that the need arises, we put the seed in, and out of His mercy, He brings harvest back. If we'll be honest with ourselves, and don't walk around saying, I got this faith thing down. I had one need met. I had a $15 bill, and it was paid. But you get over into God's system, I'm just giving because God says to give. I'm just obeying God. I'm not trying to figure out why He tells me to give it. I'm not even trying to figure out what the harvest is. I'm just trying to obey God and do what He tells me to do. And we have to get to that place that circumstances are not dictating our giving, our attitude, our level of joy. My joy comes from what the Word of God says. My joy comes from the truth. That's what Paul says. He goes, look, I know how to act. with humble means. I also know how to live in prosperity. In any and every circumstance, I've learned the secret of being filled and going hungry, of both having abundance and suffering need. Look what he says. Here's where my joy is, verse 13. We love to pull verse 13 out of that, but you put it in context, it says, look, no matter what's going on in your life, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I got this thing. I don't care what it looks like. A few years ago, I don't know many of you have heard my testimonies, but they're mine. They're the ones I got. Man, I didn't die in that. But a few years ago, we were in Peru, and we get to the airport, and the line for United is out the door. People waiting. And so we have enough miles, we have enough status with United, they have a line just for us. As a matter of fact, when we got home from Brussels, when Pastor Debbie and Pastor Bob went with us, we got into the Lexington airport, and I heard Debbie say, I like traveling, Pastor Jim. So we have our own elite line, and that's even a long line. And so I go and I get in that line, and I say, you know, what's going on? And the guy in front of me said, we're not going home tonight. I said, what are you talking about we're not going home? I'm going home. He said, no, our plane hasn't even left Houston. And I said, I don't know about you, but I'm going home. He said, no, you don't understand. There's no plane. I said, no, you don't understand. I'm going home. He said, I'm in the million mile club. I mean, here's a guy that flies a lot saying there's nothing they can do. And we're just thanking God. God, we're going home. I don't know how you're going to do it. I just know we're going home. And so we get up to the counter, and the guy goes, Mr. Strong, I'm very sorry. Now, we've got six of us flying. That's six. And we've got six of us in our group. And he tells me, there's nothing we can do. Your plane is still in Houston. And I said, well, you know, can I get you a cup of coffee? Is there anything I can get for you? I said, I know you're having a rough night, but I'm going home. And the whole time I'm talking to him, this is what you hear. He's typing away. And to make a long story short, which is probably too late, but I mean, to make a long story short, he said, here you go, Mr. Schreiner. Here's six first class tickets on Delta. Now, Delta and United aren't even partners. They don't like each other. But we fly home first class on Delta, and this million mile guy is flying coach on the back of the Delta plane. Because he kept saying, we're not going home. Go back up to verse number 4. See, I believe this is a key. Paul is saying, look, I've learned the secret. I'm going to rejoice no matter what's going on. And my circumstances aren't dictating my joy. Because back up in verse number 4, Paul says, rejoice in the Lord. And in case you didn't get it, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. See, if we live our lives with an attitude of thanks, there's always something you can be thankful for. I heard one old man say it this way. He had me in his hundreds. He said, any day this side of the grass is a good one. I like that. You know what? That's a good way to start your day. I'm alive. I got something to be thankful for. I'm breathing. Now, the truth is, see, beloved, when I gave that challenge on Facebook, when I gave it to my congregation, this is what I told them. I said, I want you to carry a pad of paper or your phone or something, and every time you want to complain, instead, thank God for something and write it down. Start keeping track of the blessings that God has put in your life, because maybe it's different for you, but here's what happens. The attack comes, and we forget everything God's ever done for us. And then if you hear someone like me give a testimony about something that God's done for them, all it does make you mad. I don't understand why you don't do anything like that for me.
Check.
Is it the truth?
It is, yeah.
I mean, you let that stuff fester, you're like, if he gives one more stinking testimony, I'm going to punch him right in the face. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to punch him in the face. He believes in healing. He can get healed. You know, there's a scripture that I've been working, 1 Corinthians 9:7. If you won't be mad, I'm going to make you mad. And because most of us know what the beginning of the scripture says. It says, no one goes to war at their own expense. We know that part of it. I didn't know what the rest of the verse said. And so the Lord started laying it on my heart. I began to study it. And what it says is nobody goes to war at their own expense. Nobody plants a vineyard and doesn't eat the fruit of it. And nobody tends the flock and doesn't drink of its milk. And I began to work that. Every day I'm confessing that verse multiple times a day because it covers everything I do in ministry. I don't travel in ministry at my own expense. God pays me. He pays me very well. He takes care of all of that. I tend the flock. I'm gonna get a benefit from that. That's pastoring. And when I sow seed, when I plant the vineyard, when we're starting new works, doing those kind of things, I'm going to get the benefit. And I'm really working this thing. And one morning I get up, and I've got this really weird text message on my phone. I use an app. It's called WhatsApp. It's an international texting app. It's how I keep in touch with people in other countries. It doesn't cost me anything. And there's this message on there. It says, "Good morning, Pastor Jim," and had a really weird profile picture. And I'm getting ready to delete it because I get stuff like that. It's just weird, the stuff that comes. And I'm getting ready to delete it, and the Holy Spirit says, "You might want to find out who that's from." So I get up out of bed, and I go in, and I'm praying, and the Lord says, "You might want to figure out who that is." So I text him back, and I said, "Who is this?" Now here's what the text says. It said, "Pastor Jim, good morning. Something very interesting happened to me this morning." He said, "I was taking my Rolex in to get a new band put on it, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, that watch is no longer yours, and it belongs to Pastor Jim. Now get it to him." So needless to say, very quickly, I said, "Who is this?" And it's the Christian businessman in Angola that takes very good care of us when we're there. And so he called me when we were in Brussels, and he said, "We're putting on a conference in May, and I want you to hear." And I'm going to get my Rolex. "I'm sorry. Excuse me just a second."
Yes!
Yeah, there's that look I was talking about. He tells one more testimony, I swear I'm going to punch him in the face. See, I remember Brother John Evans Inc. I like watches, okay? I like nice watches. I've given a lot of watches away. I've sown a lot of seed. And the first time John Adamzini came, I have no idea what he preached, because all I saw was his Rolex Presidential. And I'm watching that thing, and I'm sitting on the front row, and I said, "Lord, I give a lot of watches away." And Brother John's a giver. And the Holy Spirit said, "What are you doing?" I said, "None." He said, "Here I bring ground like this in front of you to sow into, and you're trying to figure out how to get something from him?"
Yeah.
He said, "You ought to put some seed into that." And he said, "By the way, them little Timexes you've given away don't bring a Rolex harvest." And I said, "To the Lord," I said, "Oh yes, I repent. I'm sorry." And we sowed the best seed we could into him. Paul said, verse number 4, "Rejoice in the Lord always." And again, I say rejoice. Go down to verse number 8. Because, beloved, this is what keeps us from living a lifestyle of thanksgiving, is not controlling what we think about. If you can control what you think about, you can live a lifestyle thanking God. Because there's always, if I got nothing else to thank him for, you know what? I was a scared teenage alcoholic ready to commit suicide that God said, "I can use that." If you have nothing else to go back to, then say, "You know what? I was on my way to hell, and God loved me enough to send his son." I don't know how you can have a down day.
Right.
But it's when you forget all that. It's when you stop remembering the things that God has done for you that you get into that downward spiral of how bad things are and no one's life is as bad as yours is. I'm going to tell you something. You ain't got it bad. I'm going to show you some things here. Are we still okay?
Yes.
Am I helping you?
Yes.
It's so. Don't you like being around people that are positive?
Yes.
Don't you hate being around people that are negative?
Yes.
Have people been getting away from you? Bam!
explain what this is.
We went out to eat at Applebee's the other night.
Oh my gosh.
Now, I mean, I'm not all, yeah, I'm always this way. I'm always this way. But I just started joking around with our server. And I took it a little further than I normally do. But it just sounded so funny to me when Debbie ordered wonton tacos, because you can't say it without going, wonton taco. And I just could not get that out of my head. I'm a wonton taco. Carly is with us, and she's like, I can never show my face in here, but inside, you know, she loves it. She's like, this is so cool. And so I called the waitress over and I said, I need you to do something for me. She said, what? I said, I just heard this lady behind this order the tacos and she didn't do it right. I need you to go show her. She's got to do the hand signals and everything. My wife does it and karate chops me in the throat. Let me tell you something. After we took care of the check, the other waitress came and said, I have to tell you, before you guys came in here, that last table almost had her crying. She was so upset at how they treated her. And she said, you guys are exactly what she needed tonight. See, we don't have any idea the lives that we're touching. I have no idea where I got the wonton taco. But Philippians chapter 4, verse number 8. I got no idea. I'm done. He says, finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good report, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, dwell or think on these things. I'm telling you, get that notebook and start writing down the blessings of God in your life. And when those pity thoughts come, those oh woe is me thoughts start coming, get that notebook out and go, bless God, He saved me. I'm a little concerned. You're not a little more excited about getting saved, because I'm not going to hell. I don't know about you. I'm going to heaven. I'm spending eternity with Jesus. What else matters? Do you understand it's why we don't fear death? The worst thing the devil can do to you is send you to heaven.
Right.
Seriously. What? Why are you depressed? Yeah. He can't kill me. He's tried. Numerous times he's tried. I'm not talking about... See, the people got a one-up you. He tried to kill me. Well, he did kill me. Go with me to Acts chapter 16. There's always something. I remember, I wouldn't say, I was only about 11 years old. And my parents live out in the country, just south of Lexington in Nicholsville. And the end of this mile-long road, they're one of the last houses. It's a dead-end road. And it is 1 week before Christmas. And we got 7 kids in the family. And we get home one night, and someone has backed their pickup truck up to my parents' front door, kicked in the front door, and stole all the Christmas presents. I was really ticked, because I had already opened all of mine, and I knew exactly what I had.
Just
and I could wrap them back up. You never knew.
That's exactly right.
That's hard.
Right.
Okay, if you didn't know, well,
I
you knew. Okay, I apologize. I just want you to know you're my hero. I know him, you're my hero. And, you know, they must have gotten caught in the act, because there was a pile of presents right by the front door. You know, the underwear and t-shirt stuff. Either that, they figured out what it was. We don't want this. I didn't want it either. But I'll never forget. I'm not saved. My mom and dad have just gotten saved. And we come walking in. And my mom just looks. I mean, the tree's knocked over. The trash everywhere. And my mom goes, well, praise the Lord. I couldn't take it. I said, what? Praise Him for what? She said, praise God, we weren't home. She said, all this can be replaced. I'm telling you, wasn't saved. That many years ago, that's 30, 40, 40 years ago, that made such an impression on me that in the midst of all that, she found something to praise God for. And the devil wants to keep us looking at what is not.
That's right.
To get us centered on, because you're not going to worship God looking at what is not. Just like Debbie was talking about the other night, or last night, that we call the things that be not as though they already were. I'm looking at the promise of God. I got something to praise Him about. I'm going to live in an attitude of thanksgiving. You know, this trip home from Peru, we're at the airport, and they come up, we're ready to board the plane, and they come out and they go, there's mechanical problems with the plane. We're going to fix them. People got mad. Now, wait a minute. I'm getting ready to fly at 38,000 feet. Fix the plane. I got no problem with a 20-minute delay with my life in a tube at 38,000 feet. But people were getting mad about it. Well, then they kept saying 20 minutes, 20 minutes, and now people are getting furious. We're like, fix the plane. It's okay. Then we found out it was just the interior lights, and we said, look, we got iPhones. We don't need lights. We can just turn our flashlights on. So we finally get on the plane an hour and a half late. I'm praising God that they fixed it, that they know how to fix it. Here I am in South America, and they got people here that can fix my plane. Thank you, Jesus. So we get on the plane. We're an hour outside of Houston, and the pilot comes on and says, the storm, this is the flooding in Houston on Monday. I think 20 inches of rain is what they said they got. You're being diverted to New Orleans. And so they divert us to the New Orleans airport, which is not nearly as fancy as your international airport here in Peoria.
Okay.
But the airport in New Orleans is used to processing 5 international flights throughout the day. In a period of 1 hour, 10 landed that had been diverted from Houston. We were not allowed to get off the plane for 6 hours. Sat on the runway for 6 hours. Now, people get mad. I'm convinced one guy faked a medical emergency just so he could get off the plane. I tried to fake having a baby and it didn't go well. People get mad. It did, actually. The plane from Chile that was at the gate we were supposed to pull up to, they said, we're very sorry for the delay, but a baby decided to come while they were sitting at the gate. They delivered a baby on the plane at the gate in New Orleans. Now, you find something to thank God about? I didn't have to watch some woman deliver a baby on my plane. I'm praising my God right now. Thank you, Jesus. No. But we're not getting upset. Getting upset's not going to change anything. We're praising God. And so as soon as we landed, I called United. And we have enough status with United. We have a special desk that we call. We have 1K, 100,000 miles that we fly. And so they said, Mr. Schreiner, I'm sorry, there's nothing we can do. You're still on this flight. She said, because they may send that plane back to Houston, I can't do anything. I said, okay, well, thank you. As soon as they opened it, still praising God, I'm safe. You know, I'm not upset they diverted me to New Orleans because I wouldn't want to land it in that storm. A lot of people get mad because they're not going to get to Houston. I believe if they tried to land in Houston, we may not have ever gotten to Houston. So I'm worshiping, I'm praising God. And so as soon as the door opens, I get back on the phone with United. And I'm for 45 minutes with one of the agents that she and I know each other so well. Her daughter is a senior in high school, plays AAU basketball, and she'll be at a basketball tournament in Lexington, Kentucky at the end of July, and my wife and I will take her out to dinner when she gets there. And she said, Ms. Schreiner, I've got you taken care of. I've got your four seats on Delta. But she said, I can't complete this because I need your ticket released there at the airport. So when you get into the terminal, go directly to the United desk and have them transfer the ticket. Okay, I'm praising God. So we get through customs, we finally get our luggage, we get up into the terminal, and the line in the terminal, as you come up the escalator, that's where it starts for United. And it's over 100 yards long. And then when you get to the United desk, I think there was 5 or 6 agents there, there had to be 1,000 people just mobbed. And they said, you have to go talk to a gate agent at the airport. I'm praising God for favor. Thank you, God. I walk in favor. I'm thankful you do things for me you don't do for anybody else. I get back on the phone. And just on the inside, I'm not talking about an audible voice, the Holy Spirit says, get over there and get in Delta's line.
Okay.
So I'm in Delta's line, I'm on the phone with United, tell her what's going on. She said, Mr. Shrine, just give me a minute, I'll take care of this. I'm the next person in Delta's line. And she says, got you taken care of, got your ticket transferred, just check your bags and get on your plane.
Yeah.
Now the woman in front of me, who was on the same flight from Peru, is on the phone with Delta buying a ticket to get out of New Orleans. We're just being transferred to Delta. We flew to Atlanta, and then we flew home to Cincinnati. I'm going to keep an attitude of Thanksgiving.
Yes.
I'm not going to let my present circumstances dictate to me whether I have joy or not. Now here in Acts chapter 16, this is one of my favorite areas of Scripture. Because Paul, this is Silas's first ministry trip. He's getting to travel with Paul. And they get arrested and thrown in prison. On your first trip, you're thrown in prison. And it says in verse 22, the crowd rose up together against them, and the chief magistrates tore their robes off of them and proceeded to order them to be beaten with rods. This is a nice day in the ministry. When they had struck them with many blows, they threw them into the prison, commanding the jailer to guard them securely. And he, having received such a command, threw them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. So they're not just in jail, they're in solitary. And we're not talking about our plush hotel jails today. This is a hole in the ground with no indoor plumbing. And they're not taking you outside. You're really onto this poop thing, aren't you, Pastor? So was my grandson. Our grandson is 3 years old. It's his favorite word in the entire English language. Poop.
That's Jeff, too.
That's Jeff?
2 years old.
Yeah. Well, we had the exterminators come out to the church last week. We had wasps around the building. And so I had to go let him in the sanctuary. I'm walking out the front door. My grandson goes, Papa! I said, what culture? He goes, don't poop in your underwear! And the look on the exterminator's face was like, is this a problem? Because we got this. You just stay here. Don't poop in your underwear. He's the funniest little kid, and he knows it. They're really working, and my dog's probably mad at me, but they're really working at teaching him manners. And so they're driving into the office a couple weeks ago, and he farted. I mean, he passed gas. He burned calories. And so he goes, excuse me. And you know that mom feeling when like what you're teaching them is coming across and they're learning. And he goes, excuse me, from my butt. Verse 24, don't y'all tell her I told that story. Verse 24, and he, having received such a command, threw them. Look, do you see the words that they're using? Threw them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. Verse 25. Now, this is a video I want to see when I get to heaven. But at about midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang songs unto God. Now, I can just see Paul go, let's sing, Silas. I'm singing. You want me to sing? Swing low. Sweet. What in the world do they have to be singing about? Because if you ever been in the middle of your major battle, and you get that, you get the Holy Spirit just kind of pressing you, sing, praise me. I got nothing to praise you about. Get me out of this and then I'll praise you. Isn't that most of our attitude? I'll worship you on the other side of this. And Paul and Silas started, what do they have to worship for? They're alive. They're still alive. See, you got to find a place to start to let that thankfulness boil up on the inside of you. But what the devil works to do is to keep you centered on what is not. And he'll defeat you because he'll take your strength. And beloved, if you don't stop it at the beginning of that, it'll take you into deep depression.
That's right.
if you allow it to. And then you need, I'm not saying you don't need help anyway from other people in the body, but then you need help to get out of that hole. But that's what happens. You get in that hole and you don't want anybody around you. The devil works to separate you from the place that you're supposed to be. Isn't it funny? We know enough in the natural, something wrong in our body, get to the doctor. Something wrong with our eyes, get to the eye doctor. Something wrong with our ears, get to the ear doctor. Something wrong with us spiritually, oh, stay away from church. Isn't it funny? When you get in that funk, where's the last place on earth you want to be? The place you need to be to get it taken care of. I could just see Paul and Silas. Silas go, what do we got to worship about? Paul said, we're still alive. We got a captive audience. We can preach all night and they can't go anywhere. Because I know Paul. Can you imagine Paul in the prison chained to a guard? I mean, I bet the guards are begging. Can we just do 30 minutes? I mean, please, this 4-hour thing is too long. Paul won't shut up. I can just see him going, we're preaching the gospel. I mean, seriously, Silas, yeah, we're in prison, but we're in prison for, we're in prison for doing what we're called to do. We got an audience here. We're still alive. And all of a sudden, it just began to bubble up out of the inside of both of them. And the Bible says they began to sing and to praise God. And the other inmates heard them. And what happened? Earthquake came. The prison doors were open. Most of us would have waited for the earthquake to come, the doors to open, and then we would have started worshiping God. It doesn't work that way. Okay. It's when our present circumstances do nothing to dictate our attitude, we keep an attitude of thankfulness, and God says, I can move on their behalf.
Yes.
Because they trust me.
That's it.
That's what God's trying to get us to.
Yes.
If I truly believe Him, then what things look like right now don't mean anything. Don't get caught up in that I'll be happy when.
Right.
Because that when will never come. It'll be that elusive carrot that's always out in front of you that one day you're going to be happy and it's going to be the end of your life and you're like, I'm still not. I've just determined, Elizabeth and I have determined, we're not going to get to the end of our lives at 120 years and regret something we didn't do. You want to do something, do it. Oh, I wish I could go to college. Go. I mean, seriously. I wish we decided. You know, we had friends invite us to go scuba diving. Well, we're not certified to dive. Get your certification. So we got a whole family certified. We bought all the equipment. And it sits in my garage. We have used it. But that's just what I decided. If I want to do something, I'm going to do it. I'm not waiting till something happens to have joy. I'm telling you, beloved, get a notebook on your iPad, whatever you do, and start keeping track of the little things God is doing.
That's right.
See, I know I tell a lot of the same testimonies, but do you understand what I'm doing for myself? I'm reminding myself of how faithful my God is to me. I'm reminding him of how he brought the blessing in, how he paved the way for this. That first trip I was going to Angola, I promised to go before I knew how much it was going to cost. That's the most expensive trip we take. We travel for 22 hours straight to get there. And my wife, now she pushes me up. I got to tell you something. She says, hey, I ain't riding in the back of the plane. Now, you don't know this. Business class is much nicer than economy, but they charge more. She didn't care. Seriously, you want to know? I mean, after dinner, they bring a cart with ice cream sundaes. Hi, honey, how you doing? I'm just preaching. I'll be back with you in just a second. Sorry, told the story about excuse me from my butt.
Yeah.
The only part I forgot to tell him that Coulter said it, not you.
You're a turd.
I know, but I see where he gets it now.
Okay. Okay. Bye. But I, yeah, church as usual. But I told the Lord that I'd go. Yeah, it's my circus and those are my monkeys. And then I started looking at how much it was. I looked how expensive the trip was. I said, Lord, I told you I'd go. And so I'm looking at tickets. A couple comes in for counseling from my church. And as they're leaving, he puts a check down on the desk and said, that's for your trip to Africa. And so they leave. They go home. I open the check. And it's a blank check. And so I called him up. And I said, look, do you know you didn't fill this check out? He said, I know. I said, I need a limit. He said, Pastor, there is no limit. He said, all I need is a day to transfer the money. And he goes, my pastor does not fly economy. My pastor flies business class.
Yes.
And, excuse me just a second. Now, I understand what I'm doing because it reminds me. God is a this man that wrote me a blank check 2.5 years before, they had to send him gas money to Louisiana to be able to drive to Kentucky because he was broke. In 2.5 years, sitting under the Word, doing the Word, he's gone from no money to writing blank checks so his pastor can go to Africa.
Amen.
Amen. That's right.
I'm living with a thankful heart.
Yes.
Can I give you one other scripture, and then there's something specific that I want to do? Go to Hebrews chapter 12. Because, beloved, I want to start you on this lifestyle of thanksgiving today. And so I'm not going to keep you a long time. You stay as long as you want to stay. But I want us to get into a time of worship at the end of this service. Because I want to start you on it. It's easier when you're around people that are worshiping to get into that atmosphere. But look at what this says. Go to Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 1. He says, therefore, seeing we're surrounded, also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Now, I don't know what your stand on this is or not. I don't care if we agree or disagree. I'm telling you my stand on it. I do not believe people are in heaven watching us. And that's a lot of people believe that. There's no sorrow in heaven. And I don't know how you could be in heaven looking down at what's going on the earth and not have sorrow. So I don't believe this cloud of witnesses is talking about heaven looking down on us. I believe it's talking about Hebrews chapter 11. These great men and women of faith that came before us. He says, therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus. I'm telling you, beloved, it doesn't matter what's going on in my life. If I can fix my eyes on Jesus, all of that dims out. All of that just kind of passes away. When I see how great our God is, how notice it says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, that God loved me enough to send his only son to die a horrible death so that I could have eternal life, I'm going to worship me some God. And he said, look, you want to question that God loves you? He loved you enough. The down payment was his son. Oh.
You understand what I'm going through, Pastor?
No. I'm looking to Jesus who loved me enough. If he loved me enough to die to get me out of sin, he loves me enough to get me out of this. The author and perfecter of faith. Now look at this. Who for the joy set before him endured the cross. Now, you know, everybody keeps bringing up that fixed race yesterday. I told a couple of y'all, about halfway through the race, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, there's no way they're going to let you win. Don't try it. I said, let them young guys go get it. Yeah, that's the best one I can come up with. But seriously, I mean, why did you do it? I mean, there's not a one of us, now hear me all the way out on this, there's not a one of us that are far enough into running that we truly enjoy it. Is that the truth? Do you enjoy running? Then, I mean, you run. Because I was up to 6 miles a day, and I love the feeling. I love to run. I ain't there now. I'm getting back. But what kept every one of us going was there was a finish line. There's an end in sight. There's a goal that I can achieve. I mean, some of the goal was just to win. Even by cheating, by putting a hand out. He did win. I did bring it up, though. Wait, after the race, I told Pastor Bob, I said, do you realize in real running, it's not the hand. You have to win by the chest. That's why you always see the guys go like this and across the finish line. So we went back and looked at the photo finish. And it's almost like
still, it was still.
You were still in front. I know. I think it was the angle of the camera. If the angle had been a little bit different, I won. You just couldn't see me back in the woods. That's why I was. I used to think she was so sweet.
She defends her man. All
right. Talking about my man, I tell you what.
Yeah, that's
what the hell? Who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And I want to finish this. Keep going. Verse number 3. For consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Look at verse 4. Because you have not resisted unto blood against sin. When you think things are bad, look to Jesus. What he went through for you. I'm going to put it in Pastor Jim's modern English translation. You ain't got it that bad. And there is, Jesus could do that knowing how it ended. He could endure the cross knowing I'm going to be at the right hand of my Father. And I'm not going there by myself. I'm taking all that are willing with me. He has something to worship God about. Find something. There is always something that you can be thankful for. It's amazing how we live in a society that complaining is normal. And we've let it creep into the church. I mean, it's amazing how church people like to complain and justify it. We're not justified in complaining.
That's right.
I don't remember who the preacher was that said it years ago. I love it. If you complain, you'll remain. You'll remain wherever you are. I'm not here to remain. I'm here to get everything that God's promised. And my kids don't like it when I tell the story. But when they were in high school, you know, those are back in the days, we're believing for every meal, believing for every dollar. And they came in one morning, Elizabeth and I are asleep. They came in one morning, the three of them were standing by the bed, and they kicked the side of the bed. You wake me up, you better be dying. And they stand there, their hands out. They said, lunch money. Oh, man, that was it. I said, don't you ever come in here and wake me up. And the first thing I get is lunch money. I better get a good morning, Dad. I love you, Dad. But don't come in here asking for money. You can go to school hungry. They wanted to go around the other side of the bed, but they know better than to wake her up. Then next morning, they came in the room. They leaned over the bed and they said, morning, Dad. I love you. You're an awesome dad. If it's not too much trouble, Dad, do we have some money for lunch today? If it's okay if you don't want to, but you know, we love you. Well, Pastor Jim, don't you know they were playing you?
Yeah.
But I'll reward that attitude long before I'll ever reward that attitude of we deserve this. You owe me. Listen, I don't care what you've done in faith. I don't care what kind of seed you've got in the ground. God does not owe you.
That's right.
He's still the king. And you got to go through protocol to come to him. The way's been made open, but don't ever take it for granted.
Yes.
Now, do you have a few minutes?
Yes.
Because here's what I want to do. The Holy Spirit gave me a very clear direction. There is a song. I don't know if any of you have heard it. It's the newest song by Jesus Culture. I want to give you a little background to it because I want to play this. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to stay up here. I just want us to get caught up in worship. It is one of the most powerful worship songs that I have ever heard. And I can't even tell you for what or for why, but whenever you want me to lay hands on you and pray for you, just come. But I just want us to get caught up in worship. This song, one of the lead singers for Jesus Culture, his name is Christy Lala. Last year, Chris and his wife lost their baby. They had to make the decision to either save the mother or save the baby. So they took the baby early, and the baby died a couple days later. Now here's a man that operates in a healing ministry, in a miracles ministry. He had to really get away with God and seek God about, do I believe this? It's easy to believe it for other people, but you have to believe it for yourself. And so out of that, he came out of that time with God with this song called Miracles. And I'd ask Pastor Rob, we've got the words, we've got the song. I just want us to stand. If you want to sit, you want to stand, whatever you want to do. But I just want us to worship God for a few minutes. And can we just let God do what he wants to do? And so, I'm like I said, I don't have a specific thing to pray for you for. But if you want me to, if you don't, I'm fine. Let's just let God move. We did this in Brussels. And I'm behind the pulpit, just caught up with God, got my eyes closed, caught up worshiping God. And all of a sudden, I start hearing stuff. And I open my eyes, and people are falling out all over the sanctuary. The pastor's laying out in the floor. And after about a half an hour of it, the Lord says, go up in the pastor's office. And I said, Lord, I can't do that. That's not me. You know, I'm not that person that's got to, you know, come in after service and leave before it's over so no one can talk to me. He said, if you want me to do what I'm going to do, you got to get out of here. And so Elizabeth and I went to the pastor. We went up in her office. That went on for another 30 minutes. Nobody left. Everybody caught up in the presence of God. And Elizabeth looked at me and she said, they had to see they could do this without you. And so I'm not saying that's what's going to happen today. I'm not going to disappear. Unless the trumpet sounds, I'm out of here on the first look. Y'all want to hang out for the end of it? Go ahead. I've read about it. You don't want to be here. But let's stand. And let's just take. And when you need to go, you go. But we're just going to let God do what he wants.